Breaking news. Twitter has passed new rules that ban street photography, and it's already being abused to silence photojournalists. Going to cover why they did this, it actually makes sense, and how they're going to solve the awful problems that have arisen. But first, I want to thank our sponsor, Squarespace. Squarespace makes incredible websites easy. Go to squarespace.com/Tony. Set up a website completely free. When you love it, use the coupon code Tony and you'll get 10% off. I have several Squarespace websites that I use for my photography portfolio and different business endeavors that I have going on. They make it so simple to set up a domain, get analytics, set up a store, take appointments from clients. I don't see why anybody wouldn't use it, but it's free to try out, so give it a shot. This is the actual Twitter announcement in their own words. Beginning today, we will not allow the sharing of private media, such as images or videos of private individuals, without their consent. Publishing people's private info is also prohibited under the policy, as is threatening or incentivizing others to do so. Now, this is incredibly vague, and they expound on it on a separate page, and I've read through it, and it's still really vague. There's lots of ugly gray area. So what pictures can and can't we share on Twitter? First, let's talk about what we can't share. This seems to be a big part of it, and I agree with their intention. Things like revenge photos, photos that defame people, can really impact someone's life. Think of some time when you've done something that you wouldn't want a future employer to see, whether in public spaces or in private spaces. Maybe it's just doing a line of shots at a bar or something even more embarrassing. You probably wouldn't want your name associated with that forever. Right? Under Twitter's new policy, if someone posted a picture like that on their platform, you could click a link and have it taken down, and the person who posted it might get their account blocked. You also cannot dox someone, and this means posting documentation about where they live, their bank account records, etc., though it doesn't necessarily apply to public people. None of this really applies to public people. This is important because it actually helps to protect free speech. Let's say that I announce that I believe the world is a globe and is not flat, and I make a bunch of flat earthers really mad, and they say, hey, everybody go to Tony's house, everybody call Tony's private phone number and yell at him about this, everybody call Tony's daughter and wife and complain about this, let's call his mom. This type of thing actually happens when people make each other mad on the internet, and Twitter doesn't want to be a part of it, and I can't blame them. The internet would be a better place if we simply blocked all doxing. Here's where it's pissing off photographers. These new rules seem to ban non-consensual street photography. What do I mean by non-consensual street photography? Well, a lot of street photography is consensual. If you've read The Humans of New York, the author, photographer, talks to different people in the street, learns a little bit about their story, and takes a picture of them with a release. This is a great way to actually learn about people. Check out The Humans of New York. But there's also a popular genre of non-consensual street photography where photographers surprise people with cameras in the street and take their picture. This in the United States is totally legal. It is not against the law, even though often the subjects really, really hate it. I read a story recently where a woman was walking out of her house and a photographer with a long lens just took a picture of her walking, and he did this sort of multiple days in a row. She didn't want to be photographed. This was upsetting to her. She insisted he delete the pictures, but he refused, and it turns out he is legally in the right, though perhaps not ethically in the right. I'm going to talk about the things that actually are allowed, but first I want to mention that the subject has to find the photo and complain. You could still post all your regular street photography there, and you probably won't have anybody complain because the person you took a picture of probably isn't following you. But if it got enough attention, somebody who knows them might see them, and they might decide, oh, I don't want that picture of me, share it on the internet. And that actually seems okay to me. I wouldn't want people taking random pictures of me and sharing it without my consent. I personally am against most non-consensual street photography within certain bounds. I think people have a right to have a certain amount of privacy, even in public spaces. Now, I'm going to cover the things that the rules still allow you to do, because what happens is people take the headline about Twitter banning street photography and they extend that in a ridiculous way, assuming that nothing is ever checked or balanced. Yes, you can still take pictures of streets. That's fine. Even if there are people in the streets, that's okay. You can also do consensual street photography. Take a picture of a person and say, hey, do you mind if I share this? Or ask the person first and then take their picture. That is just fine. You could take pictures at events. say there's a parade or a protest, that is A-OK. And that makes sense to me because those people, they're not just in public, but they're presenting themselves to be viewed in a public space. You can also take pictures of developing events. If, I don't know, there's police abuse or a fire and people are running out of the building, that is A-OK. You can also take pictures of public figures. So if there's a senator coming out of a building or something, that is A-OK. Whereas if it's just an 8-year-old walking to school and she doesn't want her picture online, that wouldn't be OK. The mainstream media doesn't have these same restrictions. They're granted additional latitude. So if journalists are taking pictures covering something, then that would still be allowed. And this is one of the gray areas because a lot of people would consider themselves journalists, even though all they do is they post pictures on their Twitter and they don't necessarily have a big agency behind them. I guess that's what the word mainstream means in their rules. You could also take pictures in the public interest. A lot of people said, okay, well now I guess George Floyd, those photos and video never would have happened. No, this would still be allowed. Of course, Twitter's intention is not to stop photos that actually report important events in society. They're just trying to protect innocent people. You can also share pictures of people who don't complain about it. As long as they don't find the picture, recognize themselves, and complain, you're square. Here's the thing. When somebody complains, Twitter locks your entire account until you remove it. You would think that they would just block the photo. No, they lock your account and say, you got to get in there and remove it. So your account might be down until you see it and rectify it. You do have the opportunity to appeal it, and hopefully they would review it, but I would bet that your account would remain locked out until that time. Once you remove the photo, Twitter unlocks your account. There's no path to suspension. They don't say, oh, post 5 photos that we have to block and your account is suspended. Maybe they'll do it, but they don't put a path to that. And good news, you still have every other photo sharing site that allows this, Instagram, Facebook, whatever. Here's what photographers are saying. They're saying, in the United States, this is legal, so why can't I share it on Twitter? Well, Twitter is a private platform. They're allowed to make their own rules. Some street photographers are saying, this is non-consensual art. I'm taking pictures of these people who don't necessarily want their pictures taken, but I'm doing it for the sake of art, so it's for a higher good. Twitter doesn't care about this. Me personally, I completely agree with Twitter's intention, what they're trying to do. I think people deserve some control over their image, even if it's in public spaces. But the challenge is, how do you make these rules in such a way that they don't impede upon the freedom of the press, the freedom of speech? This really comes down to how the rules are written and enforced, really two separate things. One of my concerns has been that Twitter would just block pictures by default without some sort of human review. After all, what I've learned being on YouTube is that social media doesn't scale well. Our YouTube channel has had videos demonetized multiple times simply because we said something like shooting wildlife with the Canon R5. And their mechanisms saw the word shooting and just banned the video. And that's what happens when you try to enforce any sort of rule across millions and millions of users. Social media sites are applications, they're algorithms. They cannot afford to hire millions of people to review millions of different images coming in and make actual educated judgments. At least that's my experience. This is a vulnerability that can be exploited by malicious actors. And it already has been. Twitter suspended the accounts of actual legitimate journalists sharing photos following floods of accounts from coordinated and malicious reports. Some of those accounts, as of right now, haven't been reinstated yet. This is absolutely ridiculous, and it is inevitable for the reasons I just mentioned. How is Twitter going to enforce a very subjective rule across millions and millions of users without some sort of abuse? The same challenge that governments have enforcing these sorts of rules, distinguishing between photos that are in the public interest and photos that are clearly malicious, is the same challenge that Twitter's going to have, except Twitter needs to handle things in real time across millions of accounts, and I think they've set themselves up for an impossible task. When I see other coverage of this problem, I see the same repeating theme from the articles and from the comments, which is that these problems are just going to increase exponentially, unbounded, completely ruining the platform, off Twitter forever. But Twitter's gonna fix it one way or another. either they're going to find a way to enforce this in a fair way, or they're going to end up removing the rules. They're not simply going to continue on down a path where legitimate journalists are being banned. That doesn't make any sense, and I don't yet know what sort of path that they're going to do, though I suspect they are cheap and profit-driven. They're probably not going down the path of having many, many humans manually reviewing things and making subjective judgments. In the comments down below, I'd like to hear your thoughts. How would you phrase and enforce these rules? All of us can see some advantages and disadvantages to this. You have absolutely awful examples like upskirt photos, and then you have great examples like people in the public taking photos and videos of crimes happening so that those images can be used to rectify the problem long term. And in the middle, we have to find some way to divide the good from the bad. Where do you draw the line? How do you structure the rules, and how do you enforce those rules in a way that scales across social media? The problems Twitter is trying to address are very real, but they're very complex, and they're not problems that society has had in a world before social media and smartphone cameras. In the comments down below, I'd like to hear where you draw the line. How would you structure the rules? How would you enforce the rules? One last time, I'd like to thank our sponsor, Squarespace, who makes beautiful websites incredibly easy. Create a professional website at squarespace.com/Tony. Set it up for free, and when you love it, use the coupon code Tony to get 10% off. You will be amazed at how easy it is to create a photography portfolio website for your business or websites for any of your personal projects. You don't just have to have one website. It's actually better to have separate domains for each individual project that you're working on. Anyway, once again, squarespace.com/Tony, coupon Tony. Thanks, Squarespace.